Good afternoon to all. First of all, I would like to welcome our today's speaker, CA Yash Jain, Chairman Sir, CA Sharad Paliwal Ji, Executive Member, CA Rakesh Agarwal Ji, CA Deepika Mittal Ma'am. Now I would like CA Sharad Paliwal to give his welcome address.
Sharad Ji. उनका जो है वीडियो म्यूट हो रखा है ये। हाँ आ गए
शरद जी, प्लीज गिव योर वेलकम सर।
थैंक यू गौरव जी। आज की हमारी इस वेबिनार में सबसे पहले तो मैं स्वागत करना चाहूंगा सीए यश जैन जी का, और जैसा कि मैंने मैसेज भी सर्कुलेट किया था तो उसमें मैंने इनको जो है आगरा की राइजिंग स्टार फैकल्टी के रूप में जो हम वेलकम करते हैं इनका, और संदीप कपूर सर का जो है हम थैंकफुल हैं कि उन्होंने उनसे हमें इन्फॉर्मेशन मिली तो हम इन डेज पे अपने आगरा की ही फैकल्टी से जो है हम ये प्रोग्राम कर पा रहे हैं। तो बहुत बहुत स्वागत है यश जी, और यश से मेरी बात हुई तो जो गोइंग कंसर्न पे जो इम्पैक्ट हमें देखना है जिसपे आईसीआई की गाइडलाइन भी आई है, तो यश जी आज उस पर भी अपना डेलिब्रेशन में उस पर विचार अपने रखे।
थैंक यू शरद जी। Before starting today's seminar, I would like to give brief introduction of CA Yash Jain ji. CA Yash Jain ji 2015 mein CA bane the, and he was practicing with PwC and dealing with Indias and global multinationals companies. Then he shifted to ICICI Bank as a senior manager under corporate banking. He is also an independent director. He has passed the examination of independent director and hold the certificate course of NDAS. Now I would like CA Ashish Jain or CA Yash Jain ji to continue for his deliberation. CA Yash Jain.
Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank CA Bharat Sharad Paliwal ji, Chairman Agra Branch, CA Rakesh Agarwal sir, CA Gaurav Bansal sir, CA Deepika Mittal ma'am, and the Executive Committee of Agra Branch. So it's really wonderful to be once again associated with the Agra Branch, and I'd like to welcome all the participants and thank the Agra Branch Committee for this opportunity. I think we'll have a great session today, and the topics that I am taking today is Indian Accounting Standards. So we will basically be looking over the overview of Indias, the applicabilities, and we will be taking up two standards on the Indias, which are the latest standards which have been issued. And also we'll be taking one of the very important and hot topic right now today due to the COVID-19, that is going concern assessment. So these two topics I'll be covering in this webinar basically for the next 2 hours. And so we'll just start off. I'll just share my screen so that you can see my PPT, and we'll begin. So I think the PPT might be visible to all of you right now. So yes, Indian accounting, yes. So Indian accounting standards and going concern, that is what we are going to take today. First, I'll basically run you through the contents of Indian accounting standards and what we are basically expecting from today's webinar. We'll be looking over the overview, the roadmap issued by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. And then we'll be moving on to the financial statements, how the presentation is, how the disclosures are required, and what all differences are there basically between the old GAAP and the new Ind AS. Then we'll be moving on to the two new standards, latest standards which have been issued under Indian accounting standards, which is Ind AS 115 and Ind AS 116. 115 is basically deals with the revenue part of recognizing the revenue, and 116 basically deals with the leases. And then we'll be moving on to the going concern key considerations in the second part of this webinar. So starting off with the webinar, first we will take the overview of Indian accounting standards. Now, overview of Indian accounting standards. Now, why do we basically require Indian accounting standards? That is one major question. It's like we were doing pretty well with the old GAAP, and we were preparing our financial statements under the old GAAP, and still it is being prepared for many of the companies, but for some of the companies it has been changed to Ind AS. So what was basically the requirement of Indian accounting standards in today's scenario? So if we see that today the world has become a very small village due to globalization and liberalization, it has basically become a small village if a person is sitting in Australia and if he wants to read the financial statements of a company incorporated in India, or vice versa, if an Indian basically national wants to read the financial statements of a company incorporated in Switzerland, then we might not be able to do so. Why? Because there is not a single set of global accounting standards that we are using. So we needed to have a single set of accounting standards so that there is a uniformity and there is basically uniform applicability and understandability between the stakeholders of the different users of the financial statements. So when did basically Ind AS come in and start for the Indian scenario? In the Indian scenario was at the G20 summit, which was held in 2009. So if we historically talk, our basically Honorable Prime Minister, Dr. Manmohan Singh, at that point of time, he basically committed towards the convergence of Indian accounting standards to IFRS at that meet, and India basically started off preparing their own set of high quality accounting standards. Now, in line with this commitment that was made by our Honorable Prime Minister, the MCA started preparing the guideline and the framework for how the Ind AS shall be applicable. So that is why we basically require Indian accounting standards, so that there is a uniformity across the globe now. Since the capital markets and basically the different users of the financial statements have a single accounting standard. So that is why we need. Now, moving on. What are the key highlights and why do we basically need Indian accounting standards? Now, key highlights, if we see, we have basically adopted the Indian accounting. We have basically not adopted the Indian accounting standard, but we have converged to IFRS. Now, what does that basically mean? That basically means that we have not just taken the IFRS standards as a whole and said, okay, this is Indian accounting standards. This is not what we have done. We have basically had certain carve-outs and carve-ins. Carve-outs and carve-ins are basically nothing but difference between the IFRS and the Ind AS. So as per the Indian economy, whatever the changes which was thought of that may be required as per the Indian economy were brought out through carve-outs and carve-ins in the Ind AS, and IFRS was totally converged through and not adopted. India was basically first of the countries to adopt some of the IFRS standards, such as IFRS 9, which is Ind AS 109, the financial instruments, one of the most complex Indian accounting standard, which is very difficult to basically adopt. And that is why the Indian accounting standards are not being made applicable to the banks so easily, because there is a huge pervasive effect over the financial statements of the banks and the other companies in various industries because of the single accounting standard, that is IFRS 9 Ind AS 109. This transition to Ind AS is basically not just a accounting entry kind of a thing that we just pass on some general entries and we find that okay, the Ind AS has been adopted, but there is a pervasive effect over the financial statements of this. The PAT margins change, the revenue, which we'll be seeing in later part of this webinar, where the revenue recognition has changed tremendously, and there has been a lot of guidance which has been available with regards to the revenue recognition. Even for the leases, there has been a lot of guidance which was not previously available and which has to be taken into consideration while preparing financials under Ind AS. So why do we require Ind AS? That is what one thing I told you, basically, that the Ind AS is required for a global or universal kind of an accounting standards. But There are other basically advantages of adopting Indian accounting standards. That is, basically improved investor confidence is there in the Indian companies. If a person basically has to invest into the Indian companies and the financial statement is something which he can read, then in that case, it will be easy for him to read the financial statements because the similar accounting standards are being followed in his country as well. So one thing is that the listing on the foreign exchanges, overseas stock exchanges becomes easier. Like if a company basically wants to list on the NYSE or maybe let's say the SwissSE, that is the Switzerland Stock Exchange, then in that case, that becomes really easy if it is under Indian accounting standards. And plus, there is an opportunity to definitely make some strategic improvements to the financial system because Indians definitely requires a lot of skill set to do the accounting. And for the purpose of the auditing as well, it is very important that we keep in mind a lot of accounting concepts and also be aware of the changes and things which are very important in auditing as well. Now, we'll be moving on and looking at the timeline. So how historically this Ind AS has come in, what has basically been the timeline and what is the present scenario of this Indian accounting standards. So if you see, it all started at the G20 summit, but much before that, 2 years before that, actually, ICAI started already preparing concept papers and they started converging the IFRS converged accounting standard. They already started preparing. So by 2009, our Honorable Prime Minister basically signed and committed that we will basically be adopting the IFRS standards. And ICAI had almost prepared the standards by then. And it took another 2 years for the NCA to basically publish the Indian accounting standards. Though there was no specific date was given that from this date, the Indian accounting standards will be applicable. But NCA started publishing the Ind AS. April 2014, 3 years down the line, ICAI released a revised roadmap and submitted to the NCA. But NCA still wanted some more companies to be included under the Ind AS framework. So NCA denied that the framework that was suggested by ICAI for applicability of the Indian accounting standards. And then in July 2014, we saw our finance minister proposing the Ind AS to be mandatory from financial year 1617. So the first Ind AS balance sheet that was to be prepared was of 1617. Later we will see how the applicability and which all companies were required to prepare these Ind AS financials. January 2015, we moved on next year, wherein NCA basically issued a press release and revised roadmap for the Ind AS implementation. And it was the next month that NCA finally gave us a roadmap for Ind AS implementation for the corporates, and they notified this Indian accounting standards which were applicable initially, which was around 41 Ind AS were notified. Now in January 16, 1 year later, NCA again issued the Ind AS implementation for commercial banks and NBFCs and insurance companies, and followed was a clarification on the March 30, 2016 to what all things have to be taken into consideration when checking the applicability to the commercial banks and NBFCs. February 2016, RBI now came into the picture. Now, since the bank had to adopt the Indian accounting standards, the RBI basically gives us direction for the implementation of the Indian accounting standards. March 2016, the IRDA came into picture. So for insurance companies also, there was a roadmap issued by the MCA, and therefore, IRDA basically gave us the directions to the insurers on implementation of the Ind AS. Along with that, on March 2016 itself, the MCA released two more standards, that is Ind AS 11, construction contracts, and Ind AS 18, which is revenue. Now, these two standards, which were issued in March 2016, are no longer basically applicable, and these standards have been replaced by Ind AS 115. Moving on, June 2017, we saw the following issue of the IFRS 17, which is insurance contracts. Now, I will basically let you know that insurance contracts, we already have one standard, that is Ind AS 104. This 104 standard is totally covering the insurance contracts and how to account for them. But this standard has basically been replaced by IFRS 17, which is Ind AS 117. But this standard, as on date, also has not been finalized. And therefore, in June 2017, taking the conditions as on that date, IATA basically deferred the implementation of this Ind AS 117 to insurance companies as well. Now, coming back 2 years, in the next 2 years, that is March 2019, RBI has deferred the implementation of this Indian accounting standards for the banks until the further notice, and there has been no further notice till date. So, if you see, or the standing on today's date, the Indian accounting standards are not applicable to the banks, and these are not even, we don't even know when the Ind AS will become applicable, but this is a sure shot thing that the Ind AS will come for the banks. The applicability was basically deferred by the RBI just because of one standard that I told earlier as well, which is Ind AS 109, financial instruments, because it has basically a pervasive effect over the financial statements. Some of the concepts like the expected credit loss and basically the effective interest rate calculations have a tremendous impact on the financial statements of the banks. And therefore, it has been deferred until the further notice by the RBI. And latest basically news that came from ATA was that ATA has also deferred the implementation of Indian accounting standards until the IFRS 17 is finalized by the International Accounting Standard Board. So IFRS 17 has not been finalized, and Ind AS 17 is basically based upon IFRS 17. Therefore, the applicability has been deferred. So one thing I wanted to make all the people who have joined the webinar clear that Ind AS is an convergence to IFRS, wherein we see that all the IFRS 1, 2, 3 is actually Ind AS 101, 102 and 103. Similarly, IFRS 17 is Ind AS 117. That is how we basically see under Indian accounting standards. So now we have basically seen the timeline and the present scenario of the Indian accounting standards. Moving forward, we will basically be looking at the roadmap for Ind AS implementation. Now, roadmap was basically issued in the February of 2015 by MCA. So the roadmap was issued for corporates by then. So we'll be looking at the Ind AS implementation for corporates, phase one and phase two, and these have basically been in phased manner. So phase one was actually applicable from the 1st of April 2016. Now this phase one was applicable 1st April 2016 means the financial statements will be prepared 31st March 2017. Under Indian accounting standards, whenever we are converging to Ind AS, first balance sheet which we prepare are prepared basically for 3 years. So there is a 31st March, let's say the phase one is there. So 31st March 17 will be the first balance sheet. 31st March 2016 will be the comparative balance sheet. And 1st April 2015 will be the opening balance sheet. So opening balance sheet is prepared under Ind AS when we are converging to Ind AS is just to make any kind of an transitional differences to be adjusted into the retained earnings. That is why we prepare three balance sheets and two profit and loss accounts when we are first converging to Ind AS. Further on, when we are preparing the Indian accounting standards financial statements, we will be preparing only two balance sheets. That is, one is of that current year and the previous year. And similarly, there will be two statements of profit and loss. So that is how Ind AS financials are basically prepared. I'll be showing you how the Ind AS financial statements presentation is and how it basically looks and what are the changes. But first, let us look at how the implementation is for the Ind AS. So phase one was basically applicable from the 1st of April 2016. This was applicable to all the companies which are having a net worth of greater than or equal to 500 crores. So the applicability is based on net worth, not on revenue, not on anything else. Only net worth we have to check. And the net worth has to be calculated as per the Companies Act. So Section 2, Subsection 57 of the Companies Act defines net worth. I'll be showing you that in the further slides. That basically defines how the net worth has to be calculated for the purpose of Ind AS applicability. Ind AS is applicable, let's say if Ind AS is applicable to Company A, and we say that Ind AS, there is a subsidiary basically to B and C. Then in that case, the Ind AS will be applicable to the subsidiary companies also. So holding companies, joint ventures, subsidiary companies and associate companies also have to follow the Ind AS if it is applicable to their respective parent or their subsidiary. Now, moving on to the phase two, that was applicable from the 1st of April 2017, which means 31st March 2018. In this year, the Ind AS was applicable to all the listed entities. All listed entities, irrespective of whatever their net worth is, have to adopt Indian accounting standards. And unlisted companies having a net worth of greater than or equal to 250 crores, but less than 500 crores, because of course those will basically be covered under phase one. So those companies were required to follow Indian accounting standards. And obviously the holding subsidiaries, joint and associates, again of these companies, have to follow Ind AS, irrespective of whatever the net worth or the turnovers of these companies are. So this was basically an Ind AS implementation was given on the February of 2015 by MCA for corporates. Moving on, we will see the Ind AS implementation for NBFCs. This is what is happening in the current scenario. So for NBFCs, the roadmap was issued in the January of 2016 by MCA. Here also is a phased manner of applicability. Phase one is basically applicable from the 1st of April 2018. So basically the financials were prepared for 31st March 2019. NBFCs having a net worth of greater than 500 crores, it's a simple logic. For the phase one, it's a simple logic. Whether if the net worth is greater than 500 crores or equal to 500 crores, you have to follow Indian accounting standards. That is a simple logic. And again, for NBFCs also, the holdings, subsidiaries, JVs and associates have to follow Ind AS. Coming to phase two of this, which is happening right now, so it was applicable from the 1st of April 2019. So 31st March 2020, the financial statements of these NBFCs whose net worth is greater than or equal to 250 crores but less than 500 crores and all listed NBFCs have to follow Indian accounting standards. No need to mention again, holding subsidiary, JVs and associates have to follow. Now, in this, I would basically like to ask all the participants if I can receive some answers. Let's say if there is a company, let's say A is a company, Indian accounting standards is applicable to A. The subsidiary of A is B. So if we go by this logic, what I have told, then Indian accounting standards will be applicable to subsidiary B as well. If there is a step down subsidiary of A, which is C, so A is holding, C is the holding company of B. Oh, sorry, A is the holding company of B and B is the holding company of C. So will C be required to follow Indian accounting standards in this case as well? Because C is a step down subsidiary, not a subsidiary of A, which is required to follow Ind AS. So this is some question which was raised to ITGF. ITGF is basically the Ind AS transition facilitation group of ICAI. So practical difficulties were, there were too many practical difficulties in implementation of Ind AS. So ICAI has formed this ITFG, for basically seeing the difficulty, practical difficulties facing in the implementation of Ind AS. So if we have received some answers from the participants, I hope my question is clear to everyone. Okay, I've received one answer, it says yes. Okay, so the answer that I've received is yes, that it will be applicable to the step-down subsidiary. But I would like to basically tell that ITFG has clarified that if there is a step-down subsidiary, then Ind AS shall not be applicable to that step-down subsidiary. It is only applicable to the directly holding subsidiaries and not to the step-down subsidiaries of a company. So C will not be required to follow the Indian accounting standards in this case. So I think we are very much clear with the applicability of Ind AS and how these all the listed companies today are following Indian accounting standards. It is very much required, and all the companies greater than 250 crores of net worth are required to follow Ind AS. One more question I would like to ask. This is again a question from the ITFG, which has been clarified. So let's say there is a company एंड दिस कंपनी इज रिक्वायर्ड टू फॉलो इंडियन अकाउंटिंग स्टैंडर्ड्स लेट्स से ऑन द 31st of March 2018. In the next year, the company basically gets converted into an LLP under the LLP Act 2008. So, will that LLP be required to follow the Indian accounting standards? And because this company no longer ceases to be a company, it become an LLP, will Ind AS be applicable to the LLP which was following earlier Ind AS? Correct. I've received one answer that says no. Okay. So I think that answer is quite correct. The LLP is not required to follow that Indian accounting standards. Why the LLP will not be required to follow Indian accounting standards? That is basically because Ind AS is applicable to companies which are defined under the Section 2, subsection 20 of the Companies Act. So only those are required to follow the Indian accounting standards. LLP is governed by a different law itself, that is LLP Act 2008. So in that case, Ind AS will not be applicable in this. Moving on, what are the key points basically when we are checking the applicability of Ind AS? So if you see how is the net worth to be calculated, I already told that it's under section 257. I've given out the formula as well, how to calculate the net worth of this. It is very much similar to the Companies Act, doesn't require any kind of special attention. Now Ind AS, one more important point is, once Ind AS is applied voluntarily, and even mandatorily, if you apply Indian accounting standards, you cannot basically go back to the saying that, okay, now it is not applicable to us, or the net worth has come down from 250 to less than 150. Now Ind AS is not applicable. That cannot happen. So if once you become applicable if once Ind AS basically becomes applicable to you, then in that case, definitely you have to continue following Ind AS irrespective of whatever your net worth is, irrespective of whether you are getting you are basically following the implementation criteria of the Ind AS. Next question I'll be asking is that, can Ind AS override law? So let's say if there is some clarification given in law and there is some different aspect given under the Indian accounting standards. So there are two things that the law says you have to account in this manner, but the Ind AS says no, account in that manner. So will Ind AS be overriding the law? Or we will say that no, the law basically says that way, we have to do as per the law. So what should be the thing if I receive some answers? It's just a question of basically whether I've received an answer saying yes. Okay, so you say that Ind AS can override law. So this is just a question that law says something and Ind AS says something, what should prevail? Okay. Okay, so I think yes would not be correct. Why? Because Ind AS cannot override law. If there is some given by law and some basically clarification given by Indian accounting standards, then in that case the law will not prevail. Law will basically prevail in that case. The accounting has to be done as per the law and Ind AS shall not be taken into consideration in that case. So this is how we will basically be moving. So I mean, if there is any subsequent amendment in law and particular Ind AS basically says that it is in conformity with such provisions, it's not in conformity, then law shall prevail, right? Now, moving on, we will basically be seeing how the financial statements basically look like under the Indian accounting standards. What are the parts of Ind AS, how it is changed from our previous GAAP, and what are the new things that have come in under Ind AS. So a complete set of the financial statements basically include balance sheet, the statement of profit and loss, cash flow statement, statement of changes in equity, and notes to accounts. Here, what I would like to highlight is the statement of changes in equity, which is a new thing which has come in under Indian accounting standards. We'll be looking at the Schedule 3, which has been notified by MCA later on. So it gives us much clarity how the financials look like. Now, there is one another question which comes in, which is, what is other comprehensive income? Now, this is a totally new concept which has come under Ind AS. And this was nowhere in our previous GAAP, but this definitely is being planned to bring under our previous GAAP as well, along with the standard on biological assets. So these are two things which we can expect that these will come under the old GAAP as well and will be applicable to the all the companies. So what is OCI? I like to explain OCI. OCI is nothing but any kind of an items in the profit and loss statement which might basically change due to any kind of an assumptions. Like for example, actual gains or losses, which is a basically defined benefit plans. So for employees, actual gains or losses, if we change the assumptions of calculating the actuary, if the actuary basically changes the assumptions, the amount of actual gain or loss will change. Now, these kind of an items should not be a part of profit and loss, which are subject to change or which might change accordingly. So what happens is, we basically recognize such items which might change due to the change in assumptions in the other comprehensive income, and the tax impact on this OCI items is also reflected in the other comprehensive income itself. So if we read, OCI is basically, it is a part of the profit and loss statement. It is just a reclassification of items which are subject to change due to a change in assumption, like actual gains, like revaluation reserves. Revaluation reserves coming from PPE, property, plant and equipment. So if revaluation is done and if we basically have can have a different kind of a revaluation figure. So in that case, if A says no, the revaluation amount is 100, B says no, it is 120. If we select, auditor will basically select one of the figure. The management will give that this is the best estimate and we will select one of the figure. But that is subject to change. It is subjectivity. One person might select 100, the other's adjustment will be 120. So these kind of an items should not affect the profit and loss statement. These kind of an item should be shown in OCI, saying that ki, okay, these items will subject to vary. These might change. So that is how OCI is. This is why the new concept of OCI is coming, and this will soon be in the old GAAP also, which we are following right now for the companies not following Ind AS, right? So now we will basically be looking at how the financial statements under Ind AS looks like. So I'll just be sharing the Schedule 3 for under Indian accounting standards. So I hope it is visible to all of you. The balance sheet I have already opened up in Schedule 3. Okay. So if you see, this is the balance sheet of our under Ind AS. This is not an opening balance sheet because there is no three balance sheets. Otherwise, if it is a first time adoption, we have three balance sheets. As I told, current year, the previous year, and the opening balance sheet. Now here I like to just highlight some of the few points which have changed. So non-current assets, PPE and all, it's very much similar. Investment property, if you see the C part, the investment property is basically a new concept which has come under Ind AS. There is a separate standard itself for Indian investment property, that is Ind AS 40. So what this says is, if we have any kind of an land or a building which is held for the purpose of capital appreciation or for rental income. So the land or building is given on rent or it is held only for capital appreciation, then it is an investment property. The management does not intend to sell it. The only purpose is to get capital appreciation or rent. It's an investment property to be shown on the face of balance sheet. This is one change which has been there. Second change is basically goodwill is now shown on the face of the balance sheet itself. Then moving on, we'll see some intangible assets under development. This could be seen in case of build, operate, transfer cases like bot arrangements, which I will be covering later in Ind AS 115. Then there is this important concept of biological assets, which is I am expecting to come under our old gap as well. Now, what is biological assets? So let's say I'll explain you with an example. Let's say basically it's a dairy industry. A dairy company might own a lot of cattle. Now, these cattle are previously not recorded in the books of accounts. These are written off in the P&L as and when they are purchased off. But these cattle are considered as a biological assets in Indian accounting standards. We have to recognize cattle on fair value measurement. So what we will do is basically, we will just get the fair market value of the cattle. We will separate the cattle into various categories and we will get these recorded on the face of the balance sheet. Also, we will basically be recording the crops in case industry in which is dealing into seeds and all, which own certain crops, like for example tea bushes. So those are basically required to be brought in Indian accounting standards and have to be recorded in the financial statements. These are new things which have come under Ind AS. Then we will see basically the financial assets. These financial assets are basically nothing but the things which are dealt in Ind AS 109, which are very much similar, not much attention required in this cases. Right. So moving on, we have current assets, which are very much similar, so doesn't require much attention. And then we're moving on to the equity and liability side. This equity and liability side, which is there, again, financial liabilities is one point where I would like to highlight. Financial liabilities have been basically brought in, and these are dealt again by Ind AS 109. The borrowings, trade payables, other financial liabilities like security deposits and all are covered under these financial liabilities, Ind AS 109. The other thing which I would like to highlight from this notification by MCA is the statement of changes in equity. Now, this statement of changes in equity, which is there, this is a new statement which has come in. We don't prepare this under our previous gap. Then what does this basically show us? This basically covers the reserves and surplus. If you see, the reserves and surplus portion is covered over here. Then share application, money, pending allotment, equity component of the financial instruments, debt is dealt by 109, debt instruments, all these are dealt by 109. So Ind AS financial instruments. We have to give the opening balances, changes, and any restatements that have been made. So this is totally a new statement which has come under the Indian accounting standards. Going down and looking at the profit and loss statement, if we see the profit and loss statement, just one point I want to highlight that is OCI, which we have already understood. So I hope the profit and loss statement is visible to all. So herein, if we see, the statement of profit and loss is very much similar to what we prepare in our previous gap for companies. But if we go down and see this point, the other comprehensive income. This other comprehensive income is a new concept which has come in. It's a part of the profit and loss statement. But if you see the IFRS, it is not a part of the profit and loss statement. It's a separate statement that they prepare. But this is a change that Ind AS has from IFRS. As I told, this is not a adoption. This is a basically a convergence and not an adoption. So this OCI will be recorded this way in the financial statements. So I think that is how the financial statements under Ind AS looks like. And we are mostly done with the presentation part. I would just want to highlight some of the key gap differences also to all of us. That is, these are very simple concepts that I've already explained. If you see, there is basically no concept of prior period items and no separate disclosure of extraordinary items under Ind AS. So we do not have prior period items, extraordinary items, that's all gone. We do not represent all these things under Ind AS. I have already told about a new concept of biological assets and investment property. Goodwill is to be shown on face of balance sheet, as I have already shown from the Ind AS MCA notification. There is a separate disclosure basically required for the earning per share for continuing and discontinuing operations separately. This was not required previously. Material disclosures or material items are very much accepted under Ind AS. Ind AS has one concept: the more the disclosures, the better it is. The Ind AS financials are very, very lengthy. One thing is very clear, it's very lengthy. The more disclosures, the more is the work of the auditor, but it is but it is basically required that India shall have a lot of disclosures. So even if the disclosures are not required by NDAs and some things are material auditor finds ki okay, these should be are part of the financials, then we can make it a part. And last point is trade receivables exceeding 6 months are no longer required to be disclosed under NDAs financials. So I think we are done with the overview part and the applicability of NDAs. We'll be moving on to the technical standards. I think these are very technical. Because Ind AS 115 deals with revenue, and the next standard that we will be taking is leases. So we'll be starting off with this standard, revenue from contracts with customers. This is what it is called under Ind AS. Now we'll be looking at this scope. What is the scope? So the standard basically is applicable to all the contracts and customers. These are two very important concepts under Ind AS 115, contract and customer. The next slide will show you the definitions of contract and customers. This standard does not deal with lease contracts. Obviously, it is under Ind AS 116. Insurance contracts, Ind AS 1117, which is under preparation, but presently Ind AS 104. Financial instruments, Ind AS 109. And non-monetary exchanges between entities. Like for example, let's say if there is an oil manufacturing companies or oil basically extraction of these companies, and two companies basically have a contract that one company will give one kind of an oil to the another company, and similarly the other company will give their oil. So in that case, this is a barter kind of a system. It does not have commercial substance. So in this case, this standard will not deal with such kind of an arrangements. So definitions are given under this standard. What is a contract? Now, these two definitions, contract and customer, are the most important things in Ind AS 115. If we look back to our old accounting standard, AS 9 had a very brief explanation regarding what is to be, how is to be recorded, revenue is to be recorded. It gave us explanation for goods, for services, for royalties, for penalties, but and dividends also, but not much of an explanation was given under AS 9. Even under Ind AS 18, which is now gone and replaced by Ind AS 115, not much explanation was given. But Ind AS 115 has a lot of explanation regarding how the revenue should be recognized. And this revenue standard affects all the companies across various industries. So now what is a contract? Contract is an agreement between two or more parties creating an enforceable rights and obligations. Correct? So this is an agreement, two parties, in between two parties, and it creates an enforceable rights and obligations between both the parties. It could be written, oral, or as per the customary business practices. Now, who is a customer? A customer is basically a party that has contracted with an entity to obtain goods or services for consideration. And these goods or services should be an ordinary activity of the company. So these two definitions are very important. Contract, we have to identify, okay, this is a contract and this is our customer. So if an entity is basically, let's say, dealing in manufacturing of shoes, and entity is getting into a contract with a third party for selling of some other item, which is not shoes, except that, then he is not a customer because they are not basically dealing in the ordinary course of business. This is not ordinary activity of that business. Now, two definitions are more, contract asset and contract liability. I would like to explain this with an example. What is it? Let's say if there is a party A and party B, they both have a contract. Party B is a customer of party A, and A sells his goods to party B, and the goods are basically transferred to party B, and these goods are basically in the possession of B. But the B has not yet paid to A the consideration as per the contract and on the reporting date. So on the reporting date, there is a requirement of a contract asset to be recognized by A and contract liability to be recognized by B. So this is a new concept which is coming in through Ind AS 115. I hope it is clear that contract asset and contract liability represents a right of consideration or a liability of payment for the goods and services taken. Right? So definitions, I think definitions are most important in Ind AS 115. If we understand the definitions, we understand this standard itself. Now, one question which I will put out to all of us is, what is the difference between income and revenue? It looks like it is a very simple question, but I would like to have some answers from our participants in this webinar. So if I have some answers. We have always been studying what is income, what is revenue. The standard only deals with revenue, not income. So we need to have a very clear mindset ki what is income, what is revenue, and then we can proceed further, because we have to recognize only revenue, and this standard basically deals with. I got one answer saying that revenue is the inflow in the ordinary course of business. Correct. Any other answers? Income is after expenditure and revenue is before expenditure. Okay. And income is the total inflow of business. Okay. Any other answers? Okay. So I think I've got one answer which is perfectly correct from Arvind Agarwal ji. So income is a basically broader concept, and revenue is a smaller concept as compared to income. Revenue is basically a subset of income. Now, through an example, I like to explain, like, let's say if an entity basically sells off its fixed assets and it receives certain consideration for that fixed assets. This consideration that it is receiving for the selling of that fixed assets is actually an income. Revenue is something which we basically receive from the ordinary course of business of the activity. A shoe manufacturer selling his shoes is basically whatever income he is receiving from the selling of that shoes is revenue. So revenue is basically a smaller concept as compared to income. Income is anything which basically is received by the entity. So that is pretty correct, I think, that answer that I've received. Because this standard only deals with the part of revenue. Okay, so moving on, now that we have understood, there is a 5-step model which has been given under the Ind AS 115. We will be looking on what is this 5-step model. This 5-step model, if we follow, then only we arrive at the final decision whether to recognize revenue or not. And if we do have to recognize revenue, how do we recognize revenue? So step one, we have to identify the contract with the customer. So as I told that the definition is really important in this case. So contract and customer definition has to be very clear before we move on to step one. Step two is basically identifying the separate performance obligation. So we'll be basically taking all the steps in details in the next coming up slides. Step three is basically determining the transaction price, which is consideration. Step four is allocation of the transaction price to the performance obligations, which we have identified in step two. And step five is recognizing revenue when the performance obligations are satisfied. So first step in the recognition of revenue is basically identifying the contract with the customer. So this standard is applicable only when a contract basically meets all the following conditions. The contract has been approved by both the parties and they are committed to perform under the contract. Entity can identify the party's right in each of the goods and services that are to be transferred. Payment terms are very much identified. Commercial substance is there. Now, what is commercial substance? What do we mean by commercial substance? So commercial substance is basically any transaction which impacts the cash flow of the organization. That transaction is called to have a commercial substance. If the cash flows is not being affected by any transaction, then in that case, commercial substance does not exist. For example, I told you the concept of basically where the oil companies are basically having a barter system wherein they are just exchanging oil. That does not have a commercial exchange. No cash flow differences are being made. So that does not basically, that transaction does not basically stand up for a commercial substance transaction. And the last point is that it is probable that the entity will collect the consideration to which it will be entitled. This was there under AS 9 also, revenue recognition, that probability should be there and the consideration should be can be measured reliably. Then in that case, even the ICDIS, the income computation disclosure standards, the core concept of that ICDIS is that reliable measurement shall be there and probable inflow will be there. If that is there, then we move forward in those standards as well. Now there is one concept of contract modification. So this is, remember, we are at the first step of revenue recognition. So we have identified the customer, we have basically identified there is a contract, all the conditions are being met. Now contract modification or amendment, there could be basically certain some cases where the contract basically gets modified or amended. It might be because of the scope, like for example in cases of any kind of and government tenders that are given for, let's say, a building of a highway, there could be a change in scope, there could be a change in the price. So all these are considered to be contract modification or amendments and have to be recognized separately depending upon whether they fulfill the criteria or not. So contract modification as a separate contract has to be recognized if the contract modification leads to addition of goods or services which are distinct from the previous contract and the prices are at standalone prices. Standalone prices is what, now let's say if a retailer or a wholesaler basically sells off air conditioner, and if he says that with this air conditioner we'll give you three free services for next 1 year, post that we will basically be charging you, let's say, 1,000 per service for that air conditioner. So that standalone price of those three services that have been given is rupees 1,000, but for three of them it will be 3,000. So individually the service price is actually 1,000. So that is standalone price. So we need to check whether these two conditions are basically being followed, are being there. If yes, separate contract either we have to basically account for it, right? Now what a combining contract, this is another which is concept which has come in. Let's say there is a, I'll explain you with an example because the literature is too much, it will be boring. For example, there is a real estate developer. The government has given that real estate developer a contract to build two basically complexes. These will have 20 floors, let's say, and these are given to the same basically real estate developer, and these real estate developer basically enters into this contract, and the price basically is negotiated with the government. The price has been negotiated separately and these contracts have been given at the same time, but the government basically says that okay, one complex that you will be making, you have to basically make the other complex also, or you cannot just leave it in between, you have to make that complex also, and then we will basically pay you for both the contracts. In this case, this is a combining contract. These are two separate contracts when we see them, but actually when we will account the revenue for this contract on percentage completion method, then in this case we will be taking into consideration both the contracts together. We will not be seeing ki, okay, the first complex is made 50% and the second is made only 20%, account for them separately. No, we will be taking them together, and then we will be basically accounting the revenue from those contracts. So we need to identify what are combining contracts. That is very important, and this is a new concept which has come in. Standalone selling price, I have already explained. Remember the AC, air conditioner example. So I think we are done with the step one. We have identified contract, we identified customer, we have seen what is contract amendments and what are combining contracts. Then we have basically the step two, which is identifying separate performance obligations. Now what are separate performance obligation? Performance obligation is nothing but a promise basically in a contract to transfer the goods or services or a bundle of goods or services, which are distinct. This should be distinct. So any promises that we make, those are performance obligations. So in the example of that real estate developer, the performance obligation is that he has to make those two complexes. So that is a performance obligation identified in that contract. Now we can say the two goods, we can say that the goods or services are basically distinct from each other if both the conditions are basically met. The customer can benefit from the goods or services on its own, or together with the other resources readily available, and the entities promise to transfer the goods or services to the customer, it's separately identifiable. Then in that case, we say, okay, the goods or services are basically separate. Now, how do we, okay, literature is boring. Anyways, so basically, if we say that along with that, in that contract of developing the two complexes, the real estate developer also has to build up a road and also has to put up some street lights, also has to make up a gymnasium, and also basically has to make certain other small changes which are required in that, and that's a part of the contract which he has to do. So in that case, these making of roads or laying down of loads, having some street lights, having some gymnasium or some leisure houses in that complex itself, there is a separate performance obligation for all these things. It is clearly identifiable from the contract that these are separate things. We have to account for them separately. So these are separate performance obligations. That is what we have to identify. Contract may, we have to identify what are the separate obligations. So complex is one, gymnasium is one, that roads are one. All we have to basically account separately. That is how we identify performance obligations. Step two. Step three is determining the transaction price. Now, transaction price is nothing but the payment terms which are there in the contract. What will you basically receive for the promised goods or services that you are giving to the customer? Remember, transaction price never includes any kind of end payments to be made to the third party. Example, GST. Goods and service tax, we only collect on behalf of the government and make it the payment to the government. It's not something which we recognize in our revenue and should not be a part of the transaction price. There could be certain variable considerations as well. Now, for example, if I take the example of Lucknow-Agra Expressway. So what had happened in that Lucknow-Agra Expressway, it was completed before time. And that company which basically completed it before time was awarded a performance bonus. That performance bonus is a variable consideration. We have to identify such variable considerations, estimate such variable considerations, and recognize in the books of accounts. There is an estimation method basically given. There is an expected value method and most likely method. Expected value is generally taken when there are a lot of contracts, similar kind of nature. Most likely amount is generally taken, might happen, might not happen. Like in case of Lucknow-Agra Expressway. We might complete in time, we might not complete in time. So that ways, we will basically be accounting the variable considerations. So this is how we determine the transaction price. Step three, determining the transaction price, time value of money. Now this time value of money is a concept which is pervasive across Ind AS. Ind AS has brought in time value of money like nothing. In a previous AS, there was no concept. Very less places we used to take the time value of money. Here, everywhere we are basically using the time value of money. For example, A is a party. It has sold certain goods to B, and B basically says, okay, after 1 year, I will make you the payment. Now, what will happen in this case? Ind AS basically, normally if we would have accounted, we would say, okay, he'll become a debtor greater than 6 months and we will recognize in the books of accounts. Simple. But Ind AS, though, under Ind AS, we'll be saying that, okay, this 1 year period, since it is not within the normal operational cycle of the company, we will have to recognize an interest portion. Let's say the goods were sold for rupees 100. So it won't be like you will recognize 100 rupees as your total income, or you will recognize as a debtor. You will have to account for an interest portion. It says that 90 is the principal. I'm just taking an example. It says 90 is a principal portion, 10 is the interest portion that is being paid. So you have to account it separately in under Ind AS. This is widespread under Ind AS 109, which is financial instruments. So that is very, very, very important to be considered under Ind AS. Now, in transaction price, we have some customer loyalty programs also. So if we are giving some cashbacks, offers, or coupons, or vouchers, these are also required to be deducted from the transaction price. So now we basically will arrive at the transaction price. Third party go any payment, deduct it. Any kind of in cashbacks, deduct it. Coupon, offer, something, deduct. Not to be considered in transaction price. Done with step three. So what all we have got till now? We have understood what is a contract. We have understood who is a customer. We have determined, okay, there is a contract. Properly things are happening. We have basically identified separate performance obligations. Remember gymnasium. We have basically known transaction price. Now we will be moving on step four. That performance obligations which are basically identified, these performance obligations have to basically be allocated a transaction price. So let's say in the similar example which I took, gymnasium is being made or the roads are being laid. So in that case, where the contract says ki, okay, we will pay you, let's say some 10 crore rupees. So 10 crore, we have to identify how much we are basically getting for that roads, how much we are basically getting for that street lights, how much we are getting for the gymnasiums and the leisure hall. So we have to identify what is basically the transaction price to be allocated to the separate performance obligations. Standalone selling price I've already told. So methods, how do we arrive at SSP? SSP, if I just make a reminder, it is similar to what I told, the service, air conditioner service, right? I hope it is clear till now, because that is very important to understand. So methods to estimate SSP is that there are three methods. Adjusted market assessment approach. What is the price in market? Simple. Market may, what is the price? We'll take that price. Second is expected loss plus margin. We'll say, okay, in service, our cost will be around 800 rupees. Our margin should be 200 rupees. 1000 is the SSP. That way we can arrive. Third is residual approach. We'll say residual approach. In this case, what we'll do is 30,000 is the AC. We'll say, okay, the air conditioner actual value is 29,000, including the margin of the AC. So 30,000 minus 29,000, 1000 is basically the price of the service. So that is how we arrive at the standalone selling price of the various performance obligations. So this is how we allocate the transaction price to the performance obligations. We are done with the step four till now. So these are steps to recognize revenue, and we have to go step by step, then only we can recognize the revenue. I hope everybody is with me. Very difficult on webinars to basically know if people are there with me or not. Okay. Now, recognizing revenue when performance obligation is satisfied. Okay, so the entity basically satisfied a performance obligation. The performance obligation obligation that is basically satisfied could be over two methods, or two basically possibilities could be there. First is basically at a point of time that we have just made the real estate and we have given the control of that to the government and we are done. And second could be where over a time we are giving the goods or services and we are basically recognizing the revenue. Like for example, cleaning services. So cleaning services basically provided by one of the, let's say a company A to, let's say a company B. So those cleaning services that have been provided, it will be provided over the tenure of 1 year. Let's say the contract is for 1 year. So that's over a time. So we will recognize the revenue over a time. At a point of time, when we have transferred the control of the goods or services, at a point of time, which means basically just when we have given the control and we can recognize the revenue. Now, what is a control basically? Control is a very important definition which comes under Ind AS. We recognize or we basically know that, okay, control is transferred, and then we can say that the that Ind AS that we can recognize the revenue and revenue for the goods and services. Now, control of an asset basically refers to the direction to use the asset and get the economic benefits of that assets. So when we have an asset basically taken into consideration and we basically say, okay, we can direct the use of this asset, then in that case we say, okay, the control has been transferred. Now, performance obligations at a point of time, what are the things that we have taken into consideration? I think I've already explained. So this PPT, I think, will be available for reading purpose. So at a point of time, I think it is pretty clear that we have transferred the goods and services. So moving on, we'll be seeing the performance obligation satisfied over a point of time. I have given an example that is cleaning services. Cleaning and maintenance services can be taken into consideration. So what it says is the literature as per the standard is if any one of the criteria is met, that the customer is simultaneously receiving and consuming the benefits, number one, or the performance of the entity creates or enhances an asset. Let's say the construction of the building is happening. The construction of a building is happening. Then in that case, there is an asset being created. So this is a work in progress. So then we will recognize the revenue as and when the building gets completed according to the percentage completion method or completed contract method. The entity, third is entity basically creates an asset which does not have any alternative use and there is an enforceable right to make the payment. So in that case also, we will say that the performance obligation is being satisfied over a point of time. Now, how is the method to recognize the revenue? We are at the last step, that is step number 5. We are now finally recognizing the revenue in the books of accounts. So there are two methods which are given under Ind AS 115. First method is the output method, second is input method. And as the name suggests, it's very simple. Output method is basically we will see the, okay, 50% of the building is complete. And then we will recognize according to the, okay, this much has been completed, this much we can recognize. Output method. Input method is basically, let's say the cost of material we estimated, let's say 100 rupees is the cost of material that we will basically be inputting into the building. And the cost that has been basically on the reporting day, the cost that has been incurred is, let's say, 60 rupees. Now, in that case, where the cost has been given only 60 rupees, 60 is the percentage that we will basically be taking for considering that how much the building has been completed. So, input method and output method differs. Output basically how much it has been completed, input how much input that we have basically put in to that building to complete it. So, these are two methods basically given for recognizing the revenue. And finally, we come to the end of recognizing revenue. So 5-step model is there, which basically tells us how to recognize revenue: contract, customer, performance obligation, transaction price, allocate that transaction price to the performance obligation, and finally recognize revenue. We are done. Key issues. Now, so there are some key issues highlighted under Ind AS 115. These are basically not taken into consideration by any previous standard. New, these have been coming. First is warranties. What are warranties? Basically, there can be two kind of warranties given: assurance type warranty, service type warranty. Now, in this case, we need to check whether the customer has the option to purchase the warranty. If yes, account it for a separate obligation. It's a separate performance obligation. Allocate a transaction price, recognize revenue. No, then warranty has to, where a warranty provides a service in addition to assurance. Okay, only we are giving assurance, okay, it will work. Or we are giving a service, okay, we will provide you some free services. If yes, free services are being provided, customer has the option, does not have the option, but free services are being provided. Promise service is a separate performance obligation. Allocate a transaction price, recognize revenue. And even if service is not being provided, only assurance is there, then in that case, only you can account it as per Ind AS 37. Provisions, contingent liabilities, contingent assets as a contingent liability if the auditor feels that there is a need to basically recognize it as a contingent liability. So that is how warranties are dealt in with Ind AS 115. Next issue is basically the principal and versus agent, which has been again highlighted by 115. So this is a very simple concept, so I'll just rush through this. So we need to just check the primary responsibility of the goods, who has the primary responsibility. So let's say if A is a company manufacturing the goods, B is an agent, and C is basically the final customer. So B just basically picks up the goods from this A and delivers it to C. Then in that case, the primary responsibility, we have to check who is the primary responsible. If customer faces some problem, who the customer will go back to, whether he will go back to B or whether he will go back to A. So generally we get to know, okay, the primary responsibility is with A or B. Second, inventory risk. What will happen if the inventory is destroyed? A is responsible, B is responsible. Price determination, who will determine, B or A? Consideration in the form of commission. So we have to check. This is one of the major thing in principal agent relationship. Who is basically, how we basically recognize the consideration, whether it is a commission. If yes, then he's an agent. And finally, the credit risk. The customer has been given the goods, but he has not made the payments. So in that case, who will recognize, who will basically face the credit risk, A or B? These questions, if we ask to ourselves, we'll get to know, okay, it's a principal or an agent. The last concept that is there under Ind AS 115 is a service concession arrangement. This is again a new concept which has come in. So service concession arrangements are what? So these service concession arrangements are basically nothing but the arrangement between a public and a private party. So there have been a lot of arrangements which we can see in today's scenario, like public-private partnership. So in this case, what happens, like, for example, BOT, build, operate, transfer. even our Yamuna Expressway, it's a BOT concept. So there is a separate accounting that has been highlighted under Ind AS and also under the IFRIC 12, which is International Financial Interpretations Committee, which has given guidance on how to recognize these kind of an arrangements. So these service concession arrangements has to involve a public party and a private party. This has to be generally a BOT, build, operate, transfer. We generally see in case of toll, toll collections and tollways and highways that we basically prepare. So how do we basically know that basically arrangement is falling under a service concession arrangement and has to be accounted under SCA? So if you see this, the guarantor, basically we have to see two conditions. Guarantor, who is a guarantor? Guarantor is generally the public entity, government. Operator is no one but the private sector entity. So operator is private sector and guarantor is the government. So the guarantor basically controls or regulates what services the operator must provide and to whom and at what price. And the guarantor controls to ownership of beneficial entitlement or otherwise significant residual interest in the infra at the end of the arrangement. So if these two conditions are basically followed, then in that case we say, okay, the arrangement is falling under service concession arrangements and we have to account it accordingly. So there are two basically accounting principles given, that is intangible assets and financial assets. How do we account it? So through an example, I would like to explain this. So let's say if a company is there, A company, and it has come into a contract with the government. The government has given the contract to build a tollway, and the government basically says, okay, you maintain this tollway for the next 5 years, and you have to you have to basically collect the toll, and that toll which you collect is your responsibility. Means the revenue, it might be 10 rupees, it might be 100 rupees, whatever you are collecting, it's your responsibility. We will give you the rates, we'll determine you the price, but it depends upon you how many cars or trucks or whatever the vehicles basically pass through. It's your income, it's a variable kind of an income. So in that case, we will recognize an intangible asset because we don't know, we have a right to use that toll. We are not receiving any fixed payment for the government. Government is saying, okay, 5 years you maintain, and each year I will pay you, let's say 10 crore rupees, 20 crore rupees, whatever the amount is. And that kind of an operation is not there. We have a right to receive the tollways, irrespective of the vehicles, the number of vehicles passing, the revenue is variable. So in that case, we recognize an intangible asset. When we recognize a financial asset, when government says, okay, we will make you a fixed payment, toll is ours, you get a fixed payment, 10 crores, irrespective of whatever the vehicles passed. So that is how basically we account for the service concession arrangements. These are very complex accounting that we basically do. Previous accounting standard, we used to just recognize these as PPE. Property, plant and equipment we recognize and happy we are. But here there is a proper analysis has to be done of the contract. Then we need to understand whether it's an SCA, and if it is an SCA, then how do we account for it? So these are very complex things which have come under Indian Accounting Standard and 115. I think we are almost done with 115 revenue recognizing standards. Queries we will definitely be taking at the end. So we'll be moving on to the next standard, that is Ind AS 116. So this is a new standard which has come in from this year itself. 1st of April 2019 basically was the date when it became applicable. 31st of March 2020 is where the companies are following 116. And obviously 115 is applicable from 1st of April 2018. So 31st March 2019 was the first year when Ind AS 115 was applicable and companies presented their revenue as per that standard. Now, scope of this standard leases. So if we see, this lease does not cover biological assets, Ind AS 41. Service concession arrangements, just now I explained, Ind AS 115 is covering that. Leases to explore for use of minerals, oils, natural gas, all these are covered under Ind AS 106, which is extraction and evaluation of mineral resources. Separate standard has been given for that. The right held by lessee under the licensing agreement for motion pictures, video recordings, plays, manuscripts, not covered under this, and license for intellectual properties granted by a lessor. All these things are basically not applicable or not covered under Ind AS 115. Now moving on, we'll be looking at the definition. There is one important definition, that is lease. Most important, we have to understand key whether a contract is a lease or not. What is the definition that it tells us? A contract or a part of a contract which conveys the right to use an asset to the lessee in exchange for a consideration for an agreed period of time, that is a lease. So we have to identify contract, we have to see whether the right of use has been given, and third thing, consideration and time period, whatever the consideration and the time period is, right? Then what is a lease term? The non-cancellable period for which a lessee has the right to use the underlying asset defined in the contract is a lease term. Remember, non-cancellable period, right? So this definition we are done. Now identification of lease in a contract. How do we identify? There are three basically concepts that are there. Three things we have to check. All the three conditions should be met, and then we can say, okay, the contract has a lease. First, the definition should be met, and then we have to basically see. First, there is an identified asset. So the contract basically specifically says, okay, this is the asset. Machinery number or the plot number or basically whatever it is. Plot number bearing this much. Machinery number this or machinery this specifically has to be given in the contract. Then only we'll say, okay, the identified asset is there in the contract, right? Second is basically the customer has a right to obtain substantially all economic benefits from the asset. So the customer has, whatever the customer wants to do with that asset, he can do it. He has a right to totally control that asset. That has to be made sure through the contract. And the customer has a right to direct the use of the asset. So customer basically can say, okay, the assets, let's say there is a machinery which can be used for dual purposes, or the machinery can be used. The main concept that we have to check is customer should be in the position to direct the use of that asset. So identified asset should be there in the contract, machinery number, this. Customer should have all the right to obtain all the benefits of that asset, and he has a right to direct the use of that asset. Three things if you check in, it's a lease, accounted as a lease. Now lessee accounting, we'll be seeing lesser accounting, lessee accounting, how it is there. One thing I basically want to make it clear, Ind AS 116 does not basically bring in lot of changes for the lesser accounting. The lesser accounting has not changed at all if you see, but the lessee accounting has gone under tremendous changes. So the person who is taking the asset, he has to basically account in a very different manner as compared to Ind AS, previous Ind AS 70 or AS 90. We have to basically take into consideration all those things. Now lessee accounting. So there I would like to explain it with the help of an example in this case of lessee accounting, because if you read this literature, nothing will basically be easy to understand. So there just I want to basically highlight one thing, that is the right of use and the lease liability are two concepts which has come under lease accounting. The right of use is actually nothing but the asset that you are recognizing into the balance sheet. Lease liability is nothing, you are recognizing a similar kind of a liability on your liability side of your balance sheet for showing that there is a liability which exists for this asset. Now I would just share the screen because I've done the calculation and I've just made up a chart how to basically account for lease for lessees. So I think it is visible to everyone. Right. Okay. So Ind AS 116 lessee accounting, I've taken an example where I will just explain. So lease payments, let's say for this is an example, lease payments are basically, let's say 750 rupees per annum. The lease tenure is, let's say, 5 years. Discounting rate, I am taking at 11%. Generally, under Ind AS, we take it as weighted average cost of capital of the company or the lending rate of that company. So let's say if a company has to give a loan to some other company, at what rate will the company give is the discounting rate that we have to use under Ind AS. Clear? So total lease expenses at the end of 5 years will be 750 into 5, that is 3,750 rupees. Now टाइम वैल्यू ऑफ मनी, वी हैव कम बैक टू टाइम वैल्यू ऑफ मनी. इंडिया प्लेस इंडिया ऑलवेज रोम्स अराउंड टाइम वैल्यू ऑफ मनी. एवरीवेयर वी हैव टू गेट इन टू टाइम वैल्यू बिकॉज एवरीवेयर इट इज एप्लीकेबल. इट इज स्टैंडर्ड समवेयर ऑर द अदर यू विल फाइंड ओके टाइम वैल्यू इज कमिंग. सो व्हाट वी विल डू इज विल टेक अप 5 years. विल टेक अप द डिस्काउंटिंग रेट. डिस्काउंटिंग रेट आई हैव टेकन एज 11%. So we have 40 discounting factors for all the 5 years. 750 is the payment that we are making every year, correct? And we will get a discounted value by multiplying with the discounting factor. So 750 multiplied by the discounting factor will give you the discounted value, correct? And we will finally arrive at the discounted value of the lease, total lease payments which are to be made under the arrangement, right? Now, this table that I am highlighting right now is very, very important. That is lease liability table and the right of use. First, I will basically explain the right of use. Okay, so right of use will initially be recognized. Initial recognition will always be at the discounted value of the lease payments. That is 2771.92 in our case. Correct? Right of use has a very simple concept under this lease accounting. We have to do nothing. Initially, you recognize it at a discounted value and then simply depreciate it on a SLM basis of method for the next 5 years in our case, or for the lease terms in your cases, or whatever the lease term is. Correct? So 5 years may, we will basically be discounting this right of use. Similar account, similar entry will be passed, depreciation will be charged off in the P&L, and right of use will basically be credited, and at the end of the 5 years, we will have nothing left in the balance sheet for the right of use. So what will happen? Right of use is totally gone off the balance sheet at the end of the lease term because the lease has ended, right? Now we have to basically understand the lease liability concept. Again, lease liability will basically be recorded at the discounted value of the total lease payments that are required to be made, correct? So entry I'll just be highlighting. General entries also I have posted so that it's easy to understand. So the first entry that we'll be posting is right of use to lease liability. So right of use debit, lease liability credit, and then the similar amount we have recorded in the balance sheet. Both our balance sheet items will come in the balance sheet. Now, first here I'm explaining, it's very important to understand. Lease liability in the balance sheet is 2771.92. Lease payments are basically 750. Now, what will we do is we will calculate the interest part of the lease payments outstanding, which is nothing but 277.1 into 11%, which is the lending rate of that company. We'll calculate the interest portion. Now, this interest portion will basically be reduced from the total lease payments. So 750 is the lease expense that we should have recognized. We will be recognizing 304 as the interest payment and remaining 445 as the principal payment. So very clear we have to be, okay, we are doing nothing, but we are just bifurcating 750. Okay, this is the principal payment, this is the interest payment. Though there is no concept, no nothing given in the arrangement or lease agreement saying that, okay, this is interest, this is nothing. But we have to account for it. India says that. We have to account for it. So what will happen? The closing lease liability will be what? Closing lease liability will be opening lease liability 2771 minus the payment against the principal portion 445.09. We'll arrive at the closing lease liability. Similarly, we will be doing it for the next 5 years, and at the end of the fifth year, the 100% will knock off the lease liability from the balance sheet as well. So this is how actually the accounting has to be done. It's just like 750, not recognizing 750 directly into the P&L, but we are recognizing as an interest portion, as a lease liability, and then there is a balance sheet item, there is a right to use, and then we are basically recognizing the lease arrangements. This is the major change that has come under Ind AS 116. These changes were not there, at least these were not there under the previous any standard. Even Ind AS 17 didn't deal with all these things. Now I'll just highlight the general entries. General entries is number one, the right of use to lease liability. 2771.92 credit, both the balance sheet items are there. Very good, we have got balance sheet items. Now, year one may, we will be recognizing a lease liability debit of 445.09, which is a principal part of the payment, interest charge of 304.9, and bank 750, because actually we are going to pay 750. In actual terms, we are going to pay 750. We have just bifurcated for accounting purpose, okay, this is principal, this is interest portion. that is how we basically do it. Third is basically depreciation, which is a simple entry, depreciation account debit to right of use. So that is how we basically account for lessee in case of Ind AS 116. I hope with this example it is pretty much clear, because with literature it is really difficult to basically explain how the accounting is to be done. Now moving on to the lesser accounting. Lesser accounting has not gone much any kind of any changes. We have to again identify for lesser, okay, there is an finance lease or an operating lease. The conditions are pretty much similar to Ind AS 17 or AS 19. We do not have any kind of any changes. There's finance lease accounting has to be done. Net investment in lease has to be calculated. Then gross investment is what we have to basically calculate for the purpose of net investment and unguaranteed residual value. So all these concepts are pretty much similar that I'll not much go into. So again, this slide basically deals with the lesser accounting. Substantial risk and rewards are transferred. With whom it is, lessee hai, then it is a finance lease. If it is lesser, then an operating lease. So very much similar kind of an accounting which we have for lesser. Correct. So we are done with the lesser accounting as well. First time adoption of Ind AS, when we are adopting this Ind AS 116, which is this year itself. So the companies had to adopt this thing. So if you see the team cost option with PPE is available for right of use also. Remember, right of use is an asset. It is a class of asset. Let's say the lease pay, if we have taken a plant and machinery, we will take it to our balance sheet under plant and machinery. So team cost option is nothing but previous gap mein whatever the value was, we can take it as the value for under Ind AS also only one time. That is at the transition date. And a first time adopter may assess whether a contract existing on the date of transition of Ind AS contains a lease by applying Ind AS 116. So basically, what is this explaining is, if a contract basically is existing on the date of transition, let's say a contract was entered in 2000 and that is for, let's say, 30 years. On the transition date of 2019, we say that contract is also already existing. So should we go back to year 2000 and assess ki whatever the terms and conditions there were, all the amendments that have been taken into consideration should not be taken. We should go 2000 May and then we'll basically analyze. No, we can basically, what we can do is basically the contract that is there, amended, changed, whatever it is, as on the date of transition, 31st March 2019, we will consider that. We won't go back and go and change this. That is some ease has been given under Ind AS 116, because it will be very difficult to go back to 2000 and understand all these things. It's very difficult. So these are practical difficulties which come in, and this has been given under Ind AS. So first time application, basically we see for lessors, apart for specific exception, not much change of is there. Sublease is one concept which has been given, which was there, but a broader explanation has been given under Ind AS 116. And the situation is obviously more complex for the lessees. Right to use has to be recognized, liability has to be recognized. So it's very difficult for the lessees basically to account for this thing, leases. Okay, so I think I am done with the Indian accounting standards part. And we now will move to the second part of my presentation today. And this is a concept of going concern, key considerations amid COVID-19. So this is the second part which I'm taking today. Now, COVID, as we all know, has impacted our economy like anything there. And it's not only the Indian economy that has been impacted, but the global economy has been impacted. And if I share some of the facts by the Ministry of Statistics, which have shared, the growth, GDP growth of India was 3.1% for the last quarter of 2020. So till March, the growth was 3.1%. The estimation growth of the Indian GDP for the next financial year, FY21, ranges from -1.5% to -7%. I have taken considerations for different rating agencies. CRISIL, CARE, Moody's, everyone, they are basically saying that the Indian economy will grow at a negative pace. There will be a contraction in the economy. That is how much impact the COVID has made into our Indian economy and the global economy. And since the global economy is affected so much, no country is left untouched. COVID has impacted a lot. So another statistic which I would like to share is like the unemployment rate. It was around 6% on March of 15, 2020. It moved up to staggering 26% on the April of 2020, 1 month. The number has changed from 6 to 26%, an increase of 20%. Estimation is that 14 crore people have basically lost their jobs due to this COVID-19 in India. We are talking only about India. That is how much the impact COVID has basically brought in. And this has basically brought in a grave consequences. Even for our auditors, we have to be very skeptical now with regards to going concern. This is a very, very important concept right now. Auditing the financial statements for FY2020 is going to be really difficult. It has to be taken into consideration, these concerns. Many of the entities will not survive post 12 months, and that concern has to be raised in. Even if I was attending one of the presentation and say a webinar wherein our honorable past president Amarjit Chopra sir was also there, where he was highlighting how much impact basically this going concern is going to have, and young chartered accountants like us, like me, basically have to take the guidance of our seniors so as to understand what is this going concern. And we, because this assessment has become important more important than any time it was important in the previous years. We have never faced such a pandemic situation. The last pandemic which came was in 1918, somewhere around, a plague which came. Now this is something which is coming for the first time in this 21st century. So we have to take into consideration all these factors. And ICAI has basically shared a guidance note for us auditors, what all things we have to consider for the purpose of auditing financial statements or FY2020. So I'll be going through all those things. I'll be taking you all through all those guidances that are available. And first we will talk about the background about what is going concern, why do we basically require going concern assessment, why is it basically so mandatory to basically know okay, going concern has to be there. So it is mandated by law. It is given in the standards, auditing standards, accounting standards, Ind AS, everywhere going concern is mentioned. So if you see the background, section 134 subsection 5 of the Companies Act 2013 requires the board of directors in their director responsibility statement that the accounts have basically been prepared on the going concern concern. So it's a director's responsibility that comes into picture for by the Companies Act. Ind AS 1 and AS 1, both. So it's not only applicable to Ind AS companies, it's also applicable to AS 1 companies, where the entity, that the management of the entity has to assess the going concern assessment, and the auditor has to be okay with this going concern assessment. Third point is basically, the given the COVID circumstances, given all I have explained, the contraction that is going to happen in the economy, the estimations are that it will take around 2 years for our Indian economy to get back to where we were. Just to get back to where we were, that much damage has been or hole has been created into the Indian economy because of this COVID. So we need to basically have a very skeptical mind while we are analyzing and basically assessing the management's assessment of the going concern. So what is the recent development that we see? The International Basically Accounting and Auditing Standards Board, IASB, and ICAI, our very own ICAI, has given us a guidance note. Now, what does this guidance note basically tell us? So this guidance note by ICAI, it tells us 5 major points. First point is, matters an auditor should consider for the going concern assessment due to COVID-19 and the inherent uncertainties. They can be regulatory considerations, legal consequences, legal considerations, operational management considerations that we will be discussing in the further slides. So auditor has to, what auditor has to do basically in these circumstances, what all things the additional procedures auditor has to perform, that is covered by the ICAI guidance. The period for which the assessment has to be done, it is very clearly given how much for the time we have to assess, key going concern has to be assessed. Then the management and the auditor responsibility report with respect to the going concern, management has to assess, but the auditor has to be okay with that assessment of going concern because he mentions that. And the final thing is the implications on our audit reports with respect to this going concern. Correct? Now, Moving on, we'll see some of the highlighted important points by ICAI with respect to the going concern considerations. So first we'll be looking up at to the regulatory considerations. So first is basically impacts of the measures taken by the government in the countries. You see, we cannot just say that, okay, there are some bad phases or some, there are some things which impact the industries. Yes, in COVID has basically impacted a lot the industries, but the government has also brought in some measures. So the 20 lakh crore package which announced by our Honorable Minister, Sri Narendra Modi. So that has basically brought in some relief. The ECLGS schemes which have been given up by the banks, the expected credit loss scheme. So that all basically is basically given into consideration, and it helps the industries or the flow of money into the economy. So that measures has to be taken into consideration. These are mitigating factors. We will basically see that. But not all industries are affected with this. So we need to be very sure that how the industry is getting impacted. Regulatory consideration. Second point is basically whether the financials of the management or the entity will basically be prepared timely, and the management will basically be able to provide the details. Okay, so management will basically be able to provide the financial information on timely basis, and the financial statements will be prepared on timely basis. That we have to consider, we have to analyze and see whether this will happen or not. So these are first regulatory considerations. Moving on to the next is the operating environmental considerations. So whether there are some restructuring plans from the entity, like for example store closures, for example workforce reductions, for example cutting off bonuses, for example of decreasing the salaries or cutting off salaries basically of the employees. So what all measures entities are taking, level of lost revenue and the cash flows and the effects of rebates and allowances, loss of existing contracts and future contracts. Because let's say if an entity is exporting its shoes, for example, and this entity is basically exporting to a country, let's say China or US, presently they might not be receiving any kind of a contract from those countries, and the future is also very uncertain. What will happen, it's not very clear. In this case, we have to get into assess key whether the contracts, existing contracts, will be fulfilled, and whether the company has future book for the future contracts, whether they will basically be getting revenue from these contracts. Significant deterioration of inventory, like perishable items or basically any kind of an item which degrade over a period of time, whether if there are no contracts or the industry inventory is not sold off, that may degrade. So those inventories have to be written off. So all those things have to be considered. Inability to honor certain terms of the contracts, which will lead to penalties, additional basically burden on the entity. Again, this has to be considered. Overseas suppliers, as I told, raw material, if we are purchasing raw material or we are exporting our goods, both the cases we will not be able to we will basically have to consider for the purpose of our report. Now foreign exchange fluctuations, obviously because of the such volatility in the capital markets, has to be considered. Now liquidity considerations, risk relating to receivables like delays or failures, request for any change in the payment terms because there is no inflow, the debtors are basically not receiving any money. So in that case, they will not be able to make the payments to our entities. And in that case, what will be the consideration in, and in what case the cash flows will be maintained. Impact of trade financing, such as letter of credit, shipping, payment terms, what all changes are banks are basically requesting the changes, or what all changes we can maintain, and any kind of penalties that might come in because of this. Potential covenant breaches, again penalties will come in. Credit ratings will come down for those entities. Material adverse changes in events of debt agreements, like with banks once again. So these all considerations have to be taken for liquidity purposes. So this can impact our assessment of going concerns. These are certain factors which we need to consider for the purpose of assessing the going concern factor. And accordingly, we will talk to the management, what is the management's assessment, and then we will basically give our assessment and accordingly issue our audit report. But this is really important in these times of COVID and for this financial year. Next is, as I talked about the mitigating factors, like the government schemes and government measures that they are taking, suspension of performance bonuses, capital reductions, reduction in dividend, all the mitigating factors also have to be considered. So not only we'll be seeing some factors which impact our entities going concern, but also mitigating factors which are coming in for the, like for example, the MSME sector has got 3 lakh crores of from this 20 lakh crores, 3 lakh crores are allocated to the MSME portion. So in that case, the industries, varied industries in which these MSMEs are based out of, we have to make a proper assessment. For example, some industries which are impacted heavily because of COVID is basically the hospitality, the hotel industry, aviation industry, these are some of the major industries that have been impacted due to COVID. So we need to be very careful when we are auditing such industries. Next is basically the key points, the assessment period that we talked about. So the assessment period has to be 12 months. So we need to check from the reporting date, that is 31st March 2020, whether the entity will be able to continue till the next financial year, that is 31st of March 2021. So 12 months is the period that we need to do the assessment for. Then if we basically come to a conclusion saying that, okay, the entity does not basically have a going concern, the assessment has gone basically towards negative, we will basically say that the assessment not done. What are the things that we need to do? An auditor in that case needs to check with the management to prepare the financial statements on the basis of liquidation. So liquidation basis of accounting has to be taken into consideration, or NRV basis of accounting, and every asset will basically be recognized as on the basis of the market values, and we will totally be following a liquidation basis of accounting, and similar disclosures are to be made into the auditor's report and also the financial statements. So I am clear with my period. So the period is basically 12 months, and if we find out that the going concern is actually not applicable, we need to do the liquidation basis of accounting or NRV basis of accounting. Right. Moving on, what is the impact on the auditor's report? Now, there are four basically criteria or four basically things that basically comes in. Use of going concern basis of accounting is inappropriate. So in this case, definitely an adverse opinion has to be basically given by the auditor. There is no way that the auditor can accept that assessment of the management, and discussion with the management has to happen. But if the auditor is of the opinion that the audit management's judgment is not correct, then in that case, adverse opinion has to be given. Second is basically where the going concern basis of accounting is appropriate, but a material uncertainty exists. So auditor has concluded that, okay, the going concern is appropriate, but material uncertainty exists, then in that case, the unmodified opinion will be given by the auditor. A clean report will be given by the auditor, but there will be a heading under the material uncertainty related to going concern, and there the auditor will specifically tell what are the points that he has taken into consideration for concluding that there are certain material uncertainties, and proper disclosure should be made in the financial statements. Very important, disclosures should be there in the financial statement relating to these uncertainties. Third is basically use of going concern basis of accounting is appropriate, but material uncertainty exists which has not been adequately disclosed. So disclosure is not possible, not appropriate. In that case also, we will basically qualify the report, or adverse opinion will basically be provided. And fourth is auditor identifies events that may cast a significant doubt on the entity's ability as to going concern, but no material uncertainty basically is there. In that case, we will be following the SA-701, that is key audit matters in independent auditor's report, and we will be highlighting it under the key audit matters after communicating it to the those charged with governance. So that is how the impact will be there on the auditor's financial auditor's report with respect to the going concern assessment. The last, I think, the slide that I'm going to take is the additional audit procedures which are required for the purpose of in these events of COVID is that we need to basically analyze the cash flows, profits, and other relevant forecasts with the management. We need to know where the management is expecting some cash inflows or what are the outflows basically that are going to there. We need to discuss the latest interim financials available for the entity, if available, reading the debentures and terms, debenture terms, loans, agreements, agreements with the banks to determine if there are some covenants which might be breached and bring in some kind of penalties for the entity. So those are certain things which will come as a surprise to the entity. So we need to be very much aware if there is some covenant breaches that might be done with respect to any kind of ratios or anything. Inquiring the legal counsel or basically any litigation matters that might come upon the entity. So we have to definitely be aware of that. The contingent liabilities have to be taken into consideration, whether they actually become a liability in the financial statements and whether it can impact the going concern itself of that entity. So that has to be taken into consideration. And evaluating entities plan to deal with the unfilled customers orders. How will the entity will do those orders which have already been taken into consideration? Performing audit procedure, reading subsequent events. So all these are basically additional procedures. There is a list of additional procedures highlighted by ICI in the guidance note. And that is how we will basically be doing our audits for this financial year. So I think I am done with my second presentation also. We need to be very sure about this going concern assessment. I have already highlighted the key statistics with respect to Indian economy dipping, and it is definitely flowing to each and every entity in each and every industry now. And this impact was definitely there as on the 31st March 2020. So our standards on auditing like 560, subsequent events 570, Ind AS 10, all these basically will come into play, and we need to be very much sure about how the accounting, how we the auditors have to do the assessment and report our opinion on the financial statements of the entities. Yes, so I think I'm done, Sharad sir. I think I'm done on time. It's almost 5:45.
Yeah, yeah. So, abhi hum log question answer kar lete hain.
ठीक
है. So अगर कोई भी मेंबर क्वेश्चन पूछना चाहते हैं तो हैंड रेज कर सकते हैं.
आई थिंक देयर इज वन क्वेश्चन.
और क्वेश्चन है प्रेम गुल सर का.
जी
तो जी व्हेन द वैसे उन्होंने स्टार्टिंग एमसीए हैज अमेंडेड डेफिनेशन ऑफ business combination and material combination to remove ambiguities while classifying hazards as ineffective on basis of interest rate benchmark reform. When the cash flow hedge is ineffective, whether the entire loss should be written off in P&L account immediately or how will a
So yes, I think about
hedging loss.
Yes, yes. So I think what MCA has done, we have come up with a recent amendment on Ind AS, which is changes to the Indian accounting standards on the 24th of July. And MCA has basically made some changes to the different Indian accounting standards. And 103 is one standard there. Change has basically been made. The definition of business in 103 has been given a more descriptive manner in India's business combinations. And with respect to that, the question which arises is if cash flow hedges is ineffective, the entire Yes, I think I'm back. I just got disconnected.
Yes, yes. Please continue.
So, yes. So, with respect to this cash flow hedges, which is ineffective, whether entire loss should be booked off in the P&L, immediately how will the suitor treat it? Hedging losses. So, in this case, basically, the entire losses that are there with respect to the hedging will basically be taken off into the P&L in the same year in which the effect is basically being seen. So, that one... India's 103 amendment that has been made only basically gives us the definition or finds the definition for 103. With respect to this cash flow hedges, we will definitely mark it off into the P&L account immediately.
आई थिंक यस जी के साथ थोड़ा कनेक्टिविटी इश्यू आ रहा है. यस जी आप सुन पा रहे हैं? यस जी अनम्यूट करिए.
Okay, yeah, correct. So I just changed my Wi-Fi. I should be connected now.
हाँ, अगर कोई भी members कोई question पूछना चाहते हैं या जो है कोई अपना view कोई share करना चाहते हैं तो वो hand raise करें तो हम उनको जो है panelist में add कर देंगे तो वो जो है audio video mode में visible होंगे. So kindly raise your hand for any query or for
I think there is one more question from Prem Gul sir. There he is asking about the impairment of assets being shares in subsidiary in view of the changes arising out of modification of contract entered by the subsidiary with major clients. Okay, that question I'm not very clear. If Prem Gul sir could explain or if he can come online so that I can understand the question.
मैं प्रेम गुल सर से रिक्वेस्ट करता हूँ. प्रेम गुल सर आप जो है अनम्यूट करिए. जी सर.
सर कैन यू हियर मी?
Yes, yes, please.
So yes, very good, yes. Very good deliberation and presentation by you. I was Thank hearing you. Everything. Thank so my you, question sir. Is simple that one of the holding companies hold shares in the subsidiaries and the subsidiaries have their contracts with the major clients and those contracts have been affected and modified because of this COVID issue. Now with impairment of the value of shares for the holding company, how will we do that? How will we treat it?
So see, sir, as per Ind AS 27, that is investment in separate financial statements, we basically have a guidance on how do we recognize the investment into the subsidiaries, JVs and associates. So what it says is basically there is no requirement of evaluation or any changes in the investment value of the subsidiaries or the associates or JVs. We have to recognize it at cost. So every time when we are basically doing it, we will be recognizing it at the cost itself and we will not be basically doing any impairment check. But if the auditor basically sees that if there is some impairment that has to be done with respect to the value or intrinsic value of the in the company, in the subsidiary company, then in that case, we might have an impairment loss, but generally we will recognize it at the cost itself.
So let's assume if the auditor says that there is a major impairment in the value because of modification of assets, how do we calculate it?
So if there is a major impairment or major basically, you're saying basically there is some major loss of a client
That's right, because there is a major modification, loss arising out of modification of a contract with a major client in the subsidiary. Now the auditor wants to recognize this loss based on the impairment because that will affect the going concern capability of the company. Let's assume a single, I'll give you an example. I'll give you an example. Let's assume Cafe Coffee Day holds all its stores in its subsidiaries and the major company Cafe Coffee Day is listed on the stock exchange. Now the Cafe Coffee Day auditors say that since because all our stores have been closed, there have been a major issue of going concern in because of all these stores being closed. How will the auditor of Cafe Coffee Day recognize whatever has happened in the subsidiaries?
So whatever has happened basically in the subsidiaries, so there will be an investment made by the holding company into these subsidiaries. there is a major basically change in the going concern assessment, basically that is what you are basically highlighting. So in that case, the auditor has to basically take into consideration whether the investment made into the subsidiaries, will the amount that has been recognized at cost, because India requires the amount to be recognized at cost, will continue to stand good. So we will have to basically check the intrinsic value of the shares that are there in the subsidiaries and whether we can recognize it at cost, or we need to bring it down to the value which is actually arrived at the intrinsic value or at the net realizable value from those subsidiaries. So that way we can account it in case of an where the yes.
What the management wants it, it does not want it to be recognized in the profit and loss account. It says okay. It asks the auditors to just give a disclosure of the same in its main in the holding company. So the auditor says that he is bound by the Ind AS that he has to impair the assets in the books. Is he right?
No, in that case, if the auditor is not bound by it, because Ind AS 27 basically says that it can recognize it at the cost. But it is an auditor's judgment that if he feels that this investment is actually not showing a true and fair view, then in that case, definitely the auditor has to impair this investment that is there in the subsidiaries. So it can be done through a disclosure also, but it comes down to the auditor's judgment, what he basically thinks upon, and the situation basically that you are giving. So it should be a situation basically wise. The auditor's judgment has to.
So this roughly means that he is not bound by Ind AS to compulsory recognize the loss. He can disclose it.
He can disclose it. Ind AS 27 clearly mentions that whatever the investment are there has to be at cost.
Got it. Thanks a lot for your advice.
Thank you so much, sir.
Sharad, unmute me. Sharad, unmute.
Okay. Any other query from any other member?
In the meanwhile, I'll just highlight one more point in the recent cases of this Island FS. So if we see NAFRA has taken a very strict action on the auditors of one of the subsidiary of Island FS, that is IFIN. So the auditors were Deloitte India, and there has been a strict penalties being levied on the auditor. And one of the major concerns that NAFRA raised was regarding going concern assessment. The auditor did not basically did the going concern assessment properly in that case, but that is what NAFRA is saying. And they have basically banned the auditors also in that case. So going concern is becoming really very important in this case, in this scenario. And NAFRA is not in a mood to move or give away like that. They have started taking the actions on the auditors. This was also highlighted by our Honorable Past President, C. M. R. J. Chopra, in one of the deliberations in the last week. So going concern is really very important in this times, in this COVID times, and we need to definitely take into consideration all these factors. So any other questions that we have received from the members, participants, I would be happy to answer them. Definitely I'll share the PPT. Thank you.
I think there is no more question.
And yes, I think I've
time bhi 6 apna 6 baje perfect bas hone ja raha hai. To agar koi member koi question puchna chahte hain to hand raise kar sakte hain ya question answer chat box mein query dal sakte hain, post kar sakte hain. Aur
I'd like to just highlight one thing. This is with respect to me deliberating today. So this was my first deliberation. I am really thankful to CA Sharad Paliwal sir for this opportunity. It's really, really important. And it's really great to be once again associated with Agra branch. I've served as a secretary of Sikasa Agra. And again, being coming here as a speaker, thank you so much, sir. Thank you, the executive committee. And it's really great. And I also wanted to thank our past president, as I am taking his name for the third time. So CA Amarji Chopra sir, he has been a continued inspiration for me, and I look forward always to him. To basically, he's the pinnacle of all these things, all of Ind AS, of NAFRA. So it's really important, and I am really thankful to him for his guidance also. So yes, today's celebration, I think I'm really thankful to the executive committee of Agra branch. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Yazji.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Vishnu, sir.
Thank you. आज हमारे इस प्रोग्राम में मैं नोट कर रहा था हमारे सीनियर्स और हमारे आगरा ब्रांच के पास्ट चेयरमैन्स हमारे जो है मौजूद रहे इस पूरे प्रोग्राम में, मैं उनका भी थैंक यू देना चाहूँगा। विष्णु अग्रवाल सर, केजी अग्रवाल सर, महेंद्र गर्ग जी, महेश अग्रवाल सर, संजीव कुमार महेश्वरी सर, दीपक खंडेलवाल जी, संदीप कपूर सर और रोहित द्वा जी, ये जो है मौजूद रहे। और बाकी हमारे आगरा से, आगरा के बाहर से भी मेंबर्स जिनके मैं नाम जानता हूँ, बाकी कुछ और भी रहे होंगे, उनमें एटा से अरविंद अग्रवाल जी और फिरोजाबाद से राकेश गोयल जी और संजय गोयल जी चिकवाबाद से, वो भी इस वेबिनार में रहे, उनका भी थैंक यू। बाकी जो है हमारे सभी मेंबर्स जो इस प्रोग्राम में हमारे साथ रहे, उनका भी आगरा ब्रांच तहे दिल धन्यवाद व्यक्त करती है। और एक इन्फॉर्मेशन देना चाहूँगा कि आगरा ब्रांच का एक मोबाइल ऐप पहले से है जो ग्रुप मैनेजर MDA के नाम से प्ले स्टोर से हम लोग डाउनलोड कर सकते हैं। आगरा ब्रांच एक इनिशिएटिव लेने जा रही है कि आपको इवेंट की जो इन्फॉर्मेशन है वो मोबाइल ऐप के जरिए भी मिलेगी, और मोबाइल ऐप के थ्रू आप न्यूज़लेटर भी देख पाएंगे, इवेंट के फोटो गैलरी भी देख पाएंगे। तो सभी मेंबर से रिक्वेस्ट है कि वो मोबाइल ऐप अपने मोबाइल में डाउनलोड करें, क्योंकि आगे से हम कोशिश करेंगे कि SMS के अलावा मोबाइल ऐप के जरिए आपको इन्फॉर्मेशन नोटिफाई हो जाए। तो वंस अगेन थैंक्स टू यस, उन्होंने आज का ये सेलिब्रेशन जो है बहुत ही अच्छा रहा मेंबर्स के।
सर रिपीट ऐप नेम
ये प्लीज। जी, ग्रुप मैनेजर MDA, ग्रुप मैनेजर के नाम से, ग्रुप मैनेजर MDA। मैं चैट बॉक्स में लिख देता हूँ
जी।
ग्रुप मैनेजर MDA जब इससे करेंगे तो, क्योंकि ये ICI को दिया हुआ है ये पूरा, तो इसलिए आप जब ये करेंगे तो आपको अपनी ब्रांच सेलेक्ट करेंगे आगरा ब्रांच, तो ये आगरा ब्रांच की डायरेक्टरी के साथ आपके पूरे मेंबर्स के साथ में ये जो है आपके मोबाइल में एक डायरेक्टरी, डिजिटल डायरेक्टरी आपके मोबाइल में हो जाएगी, और आप ब्रांच के जो भी इवेंट्स रहेंगे उनके नोटिफिकेशन आपको मिलते रहेंगे। थैंक यू वंस अगेन। और आगे 7, 8, 9, 10 चार दिन का हमारा रिफ्रेशर GST वर्कशॉप होने वाला है, उसकी भी इंफॉर्मेशन बहुत जल्दी आपको मिल जाएगी। आप लोग इसी तरीके से ये आगरा ब्रांच के वेबिनार्स को, प्रोग्राम्स को अटेंड करते रहें, और कोई भी सुझाव हो या कोई भी आपके, जैसे अभी मैंने जो ऐप बताया इसमें डाउनलोड करने में प्रॉब्लम हो, तो आप मैनेजिंग कमेटी में किसी को भी फ़ोन कर सकते हैं, मुझे फ़ोन कर सकते हैं, ब्रांच पे अपडेट्स हैं उन्हें भी फ़ोन कर सकते हैं। थैंक यू वंस अगेन दीपिका जी, आई थिंक वी शुड कंक्लूड नाउ।
थैंक यू यश।
थैंक यू मैम। थैंक यू।
थैंक यू।
थैंक्स टू ऑल। थैंक्स।
थैंक यू।
थैंक यू।
नमस्कार।
नमस्कार। थैंक यू।